Okay, this, today's class is on locating, very specifically locating where people live, working from a legal description that is contained on a U.S. government patent that gives you the township and range and all of that information, and then being able to overlay that information onto Google Earth so that you can see exactly where they live. In addition, we'll go through, first we'll go through the process of overlaying the county information, all the county historical information, so that you'll know where the county boundaries are and that you can adjust those chronologically by the time period you want your person lived there, so that you can see exactly how the county boundaries were on the Google Earth, and then put on the exact property boundaries, so we have both of those boundaries, the boundary property and the counties. And then we'll look a little bit further, if we have time, to show some of the other areas of mapping, particularly what we call cadastral mapping, which is for use for a lot of times for tax purposes or for insurance or a lot of other reasons. They show the actual boundaries of the individual owner's property and the names of the owners. And then that kind of blurs into the type of property ownership that's shown on the local county websites, county assessors, county recorders' websites. From there, we'll probably have another class, and I would follow this class up with a more specific one. This one will show that range, township range, called the land, public land survey system of record of land description. And then what we'll work into in another class is overlaying meets and bounds descriptions from the east and from other places. Of course, they use it a lot of places, but trying to put those onto Google Maps. There are some challenges, but it is possible to see at least the outline of the property. It depends on how close you can come to the starting point, and that determines whether or not it meets and bounds description will work. Anyway, that's what we'll cover in a subsequent class. So right now what we're going to do is look at Google Earth. Google Earth is a free program that you can download from Google. It has a lot of layers, and I'm going to click on the roads layer because that helps us. Down here there's a thing called the gallery, and this is a lot of third-party things. For example, earthquakes, you know, things that are relevant to the Utah Valley. Weather, NASA, you know, if you're going to have a satellite crash into your house or things like that. Volcanoes, they're useful, you know, just in case you want to check if you have a volcano in your backyard, look on Google Earth. Or you could look out the window, but if the, you know, if you don't want to do that, you can look on Google Earth and see. So there's lots of things. As you zoom in, if I click on that layer, you'll see a whole bunch of things appear. It starts covering the entire map with little icons. And these are like photographs, and down at the bottom there's a series of photographs. All sorts of information on here on the program. Now the difference between Google Maps and Google Earth is essentially that Google Maps is for directions. It tells you where to go, how to get there. Google Earth tells you what you look at when you get there, or what's happening at the time. So it's more informational. Google Maps is more directional. But they've sort of blended together because you can go directly into Google Earth from Google Maps and things like that. So they're kind of consolidating the two products. Pretty amazing when it started out. We thought it was one of the more amazing things that we'd ever seen.
Can you go the opposite way from Google Earth to Google Maps?
The what?
Can you go back and forth, Google Earth to Google Maps?
On Google Maps, there's a little square now at the corner that says Google Earth. You just click on it, it goes back and forth. But it doesn't show all the overlays. But you still have to have the program for the overlays. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take the program, the Google Earth program, and we're going to go to a program called the Newberry atlas of historical county boundaries. And I usually just look it up because I don't want to remember the URL. This program was by the Newberry Library in Chicago, and it gives you an outline map of the United States, and it's an interactive map. You can click on any of the states to go to whichever state you want to work with. I'm going to work with Arizona because A, I know about the state, B, there's only 15 counties, and it's pretty simple to understand compared to places like Texas and Pennsylvania that have a huge number of counties and other states. The default here is that it defaults to 1864, and the reason is because that's when Arizona Territory became a territory. Previously, it was a county in New Mexico Territory. So they had Arizona County, and then it turned into Arizona Territory. Generally, the reason was because more people moved there, and eventually they all decided they didn't want to be having to run clear over to New Mexico to get everything done for the government, so they wanted their own territorial government. So what we've got here is four counties. Notice up there you've got Mojave County, and it stretches all the way into the southern portion of Nevada. And I always speculate that had they not taken that portion off for the Nevada territory, that would have left Las Vegas in Arizona, which of course would have changed the whole history of the world, because today Las Vegas would be a little town in the desert with Walmart instead of what it is today. So, you know, sometimes a change, a decision made clear back in the 1800s had dramatic impact on the way people lived and where they lived and what they did. So we can also change the dates. So we can, up here in the upper corner, there's let me move this over just a hair. You can put in the new date. So if I put in 1870, then it redraws the county boundaries. The black lines are the lines at the time that I put in up there, the date. The white lines are the current county boundaries. So now you can see the current county boundaries for at that point in 1870. You see there's a Paiute County up there, and it says X, EXT, that means it's extinct. So it's an old county that was abandoned after they formed it. And if we go take a bigger jump and go up to 1900, then most of the county boundaries are already established by then. You can see over in the eastern part there's another county that's going to come up later. It's called Greenlee County. And then over here with Yuma, Yuma was split into two counties. Actually, that happened during the time I was a teenager, so I remember when that happened. And the northern part of that is now called La Paz County, or La Paz, depending on whether you speak Spanish or not. And that's basically they're about the same as they have been since 1900. You what?
It's determined by whether you live in Provo or up in Orem.
Yeah, sort of. Well, no, it depends on whether you're from there or not. You know, if you're from, my family came from Navajo and Apache counties, primarily. My grandparents, all four of my grandparents lived in Apache County, and most of my great-grandparents lived in either one of those two counties. But you can immediately tell if somebody's from the county seat, from St. John's, Apache County. It's called St. John's, Arizona. Why? Because they don't say it like that. You say St. John's. If you talk to somebody and they say, well, where are you from? And they say, I'm from St. John's, Arizona. But if you're talking to them, they refer to it as St. John's. Everybody says it that way. It's weird. It's like being from St. George. Okay, anyway, what we're going to do with this, let's go back now to the home screen and show some of the other parts of the program. If you select a state, then you come see the interactive map. you have a list of the county and the equivalents. Now, this county list here is every division of every county back to the origin. So this is what you get when you click on this for the state. Now, why is this important? Well, this is like a shopping list. This tells you all of the different places that may have records if your people lived back when all these counties, all this parts of the thing were developed. So if your people moved into New Mexico territory in the 1830s or 40s, then you're probably going to end up looking in every single one of those jurisdictions for records for them. Not necessarily, but it's entirely possible that they have records. At least you would want to know where the records had gone. And that's why it's important to know exactly where the person lives. That's why we're trying to pin it down to a house, because a lot of times knowing that house determines which of all those jurisdictions they may have been in at the time, at various times. And that's just Arizona. Yeah, remember that if you had Texas, you'd have 200, probably 300 names in that list. So there's a lot of, it's very complicated, and it becomes more complicated as you understand the need to look through all of these types of records. Okay, so now we're going to go back. There's a consolidated chronology. There's also an individual one. Now, here we go for Apache County. So Apache County was created from Yavapai County, and then it lost to Graham County and further lost to Navajo County. So that gives you the order in which the counties were created. Of course, you can get that off the interactive map. But what we want to do here is to see, this is another checklist, because if your people came from Apache County or lived in Apache County area before 1879, then the records could be in Yavapai County. Or if they were, if they could also be in Apache County, or if they lived in a certain part of Apache County, they could have been in Graham County or in Navajo County. So you have to go through this process. I once had a friend call me from one day on the phone, and he said, I'm in St. John's. He didn't say it that way. He said he was from St. John's. He was in St. John's. And he said, I'm at the recorder's office, and I'm asking about records, and they're telling me all the records are in Navajo County. And I said, well, when did your people live there? And he said, well, they were there in the 1870s. I said, well, you know, then what you need to do, perhaps, is go to Navajo County, because they may have the records there. Because they split off, they could have gone to the new county and not been retained in the old county. And so then he said thanks, and an hour and a half later he calls up and he says, okay, now I'm at the courthouse in Navajo County at Holbrook, and they're telling me the records are in Apache County. And I said, did you check the state archives before you left Phoenix? And he went, oh. And I said, check the state archives. I never heard back, so I suppose he found them in the state archives. But there's, you know, that illustrates this, because this is a checklist, but it's not a checklist to get in your car and drive. It's a checklist to get on the computer or on the telephone and find out who has the records and what category and what time periods. But this is how you find out the basic information about where all of this stuff could have taken place. Now, the next thing down in the list is a bibliography. You can get into all sorts of history here. And then historical commentary. Down here we have what's called metadata. Now, the metadata is the information that's transferred from this program to other programs like Google Earth. So when we go onto Google Earth, you'll see as we click on the county, it'll bring up the history of that county. And that information came from the Newberry. So it'll come from this atlas here that's transported by way of the program. The next thing they have here is the shape files for the GIS. This is the Geographic Information Service. Anybody used a GIS? Anybody know what that is? Okay.
Geologic Survey, yes.
The GIS is a set of programs that define the boundaries of the counties, states, cities, anything that has to do with political boundaries or other boundaries that basically can be imported into another map. So they use that to draw individual property boundaries. They use it to draw a map showing points of interest in the state or railroad track stations or whatever else. Whatever you're using, your state's using to, whenever you click on something and map pops up, it's because they've used this GIS program. We'll get into that probably in the next class a little bit more detail, because they're very useful for finding exactly where people live. It's often used by the taxing, like the county assessors or whoever is doing taxation, to show exactly where the tax properties are. So it helps to identify the property location. One we're going to use is a KMZ file, and I've been asked already, what does that mean? And let's see what happens. I'm going to just put that in because I have time to think about it right now. It's a file keyhole markup language. That helps us a whole lot. Okay, forget that. I'm glad I looked it up. But now that we click on this, it automatically downloads a file, and then I clicked on that and opened up. When I got to this point, I kept thinking, how do I import this file into Google Earth now? What's the process? So I went online and I started to look for instructions on how to import program files into Google Earth. I looked for an hour, I watched YouTube videos, I did all sorts of things. Nobody could quite get to the answer to the question of how do you import the file? And I went, this is so crazy. And I'm sitting there with my computer, my Mac, and I decided, well, what I'm going to do is just pull that file down on Google Earth and see what happens. And so I did, and it went in. That's all you have to do. It was so simple that nobody bothered to tell me that it was simple. But it's even simpler than that. You don't even have to drag it. All you have to do is double-click it. And then it automatically draws the map onto Google Earth for that state. Now this is all the information that, the boundary information in the time frame that was in the Newberry Atlas. Up here at the top, there's a blue bar. That's a timeline, and it's as you move the sliders, the dates change. If I keep moving it, all of the boundaries start disappearing, and pretty soon I'm down to territory. But basically, I'm going to set it on 1900 approximately. And then the other part of it is a bracket, and that changes the boundaries again. And if I bring that up to 1890, that should give me the boundaries as they existed during that time period, from 1890 to 1900. So there we are with the way of setting up this. So if you're watching, you'll see that the boundaries were changing as I moved those markers back and forth. Now I can then zoom in, and you can see when I click, it tells me all of the historical information for that county that came over from that Newberry program. But I'm going to use this little, I'm going to get rid of that because it's big, like a big white sign. And we're going to keep zooming in on the property. One thing about Google Earth is that you can actually control the angle you're looking at. So you can look at it as a flat on, or you can lay it down and look at it kind of obliquely. And this controls the angle, so I'm going to pull the angle up. And then I'm going to go back in, and we're going to go over here to where the county boundary is. There's Interstate 40. And this is just to show what happens as we get in. I have to keep moving it into the center because it centers wherever it is. There we go. Now we've got it. Move it a little bit more. I can keep zooming and keep zooming and keep zooming until I can see the boundary line going down the stripes on the road, and if the car was on the boundary line, you'd see the front was in one county and the back was in another county. So you can literally go down and tell if the kitchen is in one county and the living room's in the other county. It'll go right down through the house. So that, this is a way to be very precise in where somebody lived. It might be very important to know that they lived just inside of one county as opposed to another, or just across the state line instead of one in another state. So.
You click to change the angle?
Yeah, it just bends it. It just kind of swivels it.
What did you click?
Up at the top, there's the top circle. It has four controls for tipping it different ways. It's up here, this one, if I click that, it bends it up. If I click that, it bends it down. If I click this, it swirls it.
Okay. Okay.
Whichever way I want. So I could put that line right on north if I wanted to.
Okay.
See how that works. Okay, the next step in this process is we need to know where the land was. So get rid of this and go here and get a new tab. In this case, what we're going to do is we're going to go to the Bureau of Land Management General Land Office, the BLMGLO. And this is where all of the records for the government land distribution sales are recorded, and they're online and mostly available. There's about 5 million land contract records on here, and they take care of most of the country. But let's look and see what we're talking about here. If I go to Google Images and get talk about the land, what's called the land survey system. That'll give me a map of the land survey. There it is. There's the map. This is the way that the land was distributed in the United States. The white states over there on the eastern seaboard are the original colonies plus their counties. So, for example, you see Kentucky and Tennessee. And the reason why that is because Kentucky and Tennessee were counties until they were made states of Virginia and North Carolina.
Those are also the meets and bounds states.
They what?
They're also the meets and bounds states.
So basically, these are the white ones are, and Texas, of course, was an independent republic for a period of time. And I won't make any comments about the fact that they still think they're independent, but. Just assume that. That in eastern Arizona. People in eastern Arizona periodically vote to get out of the union, but it doesn't make any difference. The thing about the state land states is they reserved all of their land to the states. So the government, the federal government, the United States government, did not own very much land in those state land states. They basically had to either buy it or acquire it some way. On the other hand, the other states, the ones that are in color, are called public land states, and they're subject to the public land survey, and those were all claimed by and owned by the federal government. And if you go, you live in Arizona, Utah, Nevada, or Idaho, you know that probably up to 85-90% of your state is owned by the federal government. And that's, you know, that the only reason the other states aren't is because they gave the land away as homestead. And they basically didn't get as far as Arizona before they decided they didn't want the law anymore. But the other thing that's important here is what you're seeing is those kind of like crosshairs, vertical and horizontal lines on each of the colored areas. The color is separating the various surveys, land surveys, that were done across the country. And each of those crosshairs is a different survey. In Arizona, for example, there's a, where the crosshair crosses was the zero point. They determined that by choosing a point that they wanted to start and then determining what where that point was on the face of the Earth by celestial navigation and various things. So they could fix with their sextants and everything, they could fix the location of that point. And then they began that as the survey. Well, the problem is that that their instruments in the 1800s weren't very accurate. And so their surveys are all off. And as they get further and further away from the starting point, from the central point of the survey, the lines get further and further off. When two surveys meet, those lines can be off miles or quarter of a mile, whatever it is, depending on how far they've taken that survey. And then they have to make a correction between the two surveys, and they have what are called correction sections, where they bend the lines and chop them up and make them so they come out, meet all of the other survey lines. So we have these surveys going on. Now in Utah, they used a different method of finding the beginning point. Anybody remember
how they started? Corner of Temple Square.
Other than Doug, who was here this morning.
The southeast corner of Temple Square.
Well, that's right. Well, how it happened was that when Brigham Young got there, he walked out, stuck his cane in the ground, and said, "We start here." And then Parley P. Pratt went in, put in a stake, and they started the survey from that point. So
Parley or was it Orson? Was it Parley or was it Orson?
Orson, one of the two. I thought it was Parley. Maybe I'm wrong.
Orson was
I'm probably distributing bad historical information constantly. But we've got, what happens here is that those lines, I mean, I guess that illustrates the point. The lines are arbitrary. It's what they just, someplace they chose to start. So there's nothing great about where they started. Now, what did they do when they got the lines started? Then what they would do would be to divide the property up. And this, I'm sorry, this is kind of a smaller image, but the upper right-hand corner is the yellow, and there's an horizontal line is east-west line called the baseline. And the north-south line is called the prime meridian. If you go around the country, you'll see lots of places called meridian, and you'll see places called baseline roads and baseline this and that. And that's all to do with these surveys. So in Phoenix, for example, the big road that runs all the way across the Salt River Valley for 50 miles is called Baseline Road. And the zero is Central Avenue and Baseline. Now, all the little towns here in Utah Valley have their own survey. And their center point is Center and Main. So you've got the zero street, Center and Main, and then they do their avenues and east-west things all from that center point. That was the good news. The bad news was that since they all started at a different point, none of the streets match up in between any of these towns. So when you're driving from Pleasant Grove into American Fork and then into Lehigh or into Alpine, what you get is all the street numbers and all the east-west things change as you go from boundary to boundary. So it's pretty interesting to drive around and for somebody coming from the outside.
20th North on the west side in Provo is 20th South in Orem.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and you can just go through a neighborhood and then all of a sudden it changes. The street name changes because you went to a new town. And there's one place up in the corner of it. Actually, the same thing happens right up here by where I live, but there's another one in the corner of, I think it's 1800 North in Pleasant Grove, where it goes into American Fork. There's a sign that has like four different street signs pointing whichever direction they have, the different names for all the different streets going in all the different directions. So every street changes at that point. Anyway, interesting, but that's what happened. Okay, then they measured out from there in what are called townships, and townships are 36 square miles. So they go out 6 miles, and they create a township. and that's the township, and then they keep numbering them out as they go east or west. So when you'll have township 1 east, 2 east, 3 east, 4 east, 5 east, it just is the, they're just the numbered out from that center line. And then the townships are further divided into sections, 1 mile square sections, which happen to be 640 acres. If you go back historically into the in property measurement, things like rods and furlongs and chains and things like that, you find out they're all related and they all come out even. So it, the numbers all work out until you start getting into meters and the decimal, the decimal type systems of measurements, and then none of them come out even. I mean, the decimal does, and the English does, but when they try to change the two together, they don't work. Then the sections are 1 square mile, and they are divided further up by quarters. So you'll start out with a description, a property description in this, in the land survey system sounds like this: the northwest quarter of the northeast quarter of the north half of the east of the northwest quarter of section 13 north, 12 east, whatever. So that'll come out the way that kind of a description. And what we're going to use is get that description, and then we'll apply that and see where exactly where that particular system works, exists on the on Google Earth. Okay, so now we're going to look at it, land patents. And a patent is a word that does not mean like an invention. A patent is another word for a deed. And why it's a patent is because the U.S. government guaranteed that they owned the land and that you got clear title to it, except unless somebody bought it earlier. But there's really no absolutes when you get into the land business. Because like in Arizona, for example, there are many instances where there were claims made because of the prior ownership of the Spanish Empire. And we have some land in Arizona. When you're looking at all the land, then you'll see this big block of land that sits out there and doesn't seem to be connected to everything else. And it's called the Baca, B-A-C-A, the Baca float. And it comes from the Spanish ownership that they recognized because of treaties and whatever. And so it just exists out there as a separate land ownership. Okay, so now what we're going to do is put in the local search for it. So we put in the state. I don't put in a county initially unless I happen to know exactly when they moved there and the county, when they bought their land, because I don't know which county it's in. Could have been in Apache County, Navajo County, Yavapai County. I don't know when they got it. So then I put in the name, and I don't be too specific because they're not necessarily going to be perfect on the names either. And then we do a search. And there's the land. There were two purchases. One was in 1927 and the other one was in 1892. The 1927 one has an image, so we can see the patent. Run it. Okay. And there it is, signed by Calvin Coolidge, President, 1927. And it's for the north half of Section 12 in Township 18 North of Range 18 East of the Gila and Salt River Meridian, containing 320 acres. So that's half a section. So it's the north half of that particular section. And that's what we call the legal description of the property that tells you the boundary of that particular piece of property. Then the trick is, how do you know where that is? So then what we're going to do is we're going to go to a different program. And this is just a utility program that I found online.
Well, just One thing, if you go back to that glow thing, if you check the box down at the bottom, it will come up with a little map down at the bottom.
Yeah.
It's not the most useful thing in the world, but it does give you kind of a general idea.
Yeah, well, we want to know exactly specifically on the face of the earth down to the foot where the land was.
Well, it does show you that. It's just, it only shows you in like a township square though. Yeah, so.
Well, this is where we want to know where it is, county boundaries are. We want to know, you know, whether it's farmland or whether it's the middle of the city.
Yeah, I'll just say for an initial look, there is a.
Yeah, this is a way to get there more precise. Okay, so now what we're going to do is, look at my cheat sheet. Anyway, had a reason for bringing that. It's called earthpoint.us. Okay, and then we're going to go to look at the township range and search by description. And now we can put in that. So now we're going to go to Arizona, and the principal meridian is the Gila Sol, and the township was 18 north. And 18 east. And the section was 12. And now if we view that, what we get is the geographic coordinates for the four corners of each of those, the township and for the section. We could take that information. For example, I could take that northwest corner and highlight the coordinates here. If I can get it to work without jumping around, there we go. And then I could run out to Google Maps and put that coordinate in. And now I have the property. Lovely, huh? Okay, here we go. And then we click on Google Earth and it shows us exactly where that corner is, that northwest corner of the property. We can keep zooming in on that until we're actually down to which piece of sagebrush it happens to be over. Or zoom out. If we wanted to see kind of what this looked like in the area, you can pull out the little Pegman guy and plop him down on the freeway. We can see exactly where they were living or where their land was. Lovely country. What happens here, this is on Interstate 40, it's on the Colorado Plateau, and this is just around 5,000 feet above sea level. And the wind blows probably 360 days a year. In fact, they're using this area now to build wind farms pretty extensively. In addition, the temperature in the winter can get down to 20 to 30 to 40 degrees below zero, and up in the summer it's 110. So it doesn't matter which kind of climate you like, sometime during the year it's going to happen. But the other thing is you have to know it, the wind blows constantly. But we never could figure out why they stopped here. In fact, my great-grandfather and his young bride, they were called as missionaries to settle on the Little Colorado River. And when they got here, my great-grandmother, Eliza Parkinson Tanner, said, "We're not stopping here." She said, "There's nothing here." And he said, so they just kept going, but then they hit a snowstorm outside of town. This was in the middle of the winter. And they stopped them. They couldn't go. They went back to the settlement, and then they never left. They lived there until they died. So it was an interesting country and an interesting place. But that gives you an idea, a little better idea of what that is. Now, what we want to do is we want to go back to our program, and we want to apply to it on Google Earth, and that will take us into the Google Earth program. So now I've got this down here, and as I zoom around, then it shows me a big square in golden, kind of golden color. Let me tip it up again so I can see it. And that's the township. Okay, so this is the 36 miles across by 6 miles. That's all 36 square miles township. And then the little green and purple square is the actual section that comes up. And if I zoom in on that section, then the north half of that section right there is the boundary of the property that was shown on the patent, on the land patent. I can go right into where that piece of property is. You can see that only in the very, very small, lower southeast portion of the property was there anything that looked green. So, interestingly enough, most of this country was a lot more grass and everything. The climate has changed in Arizona. It's dried out over the last 100 years or so. And there's been a lot of overgrazing. So it looks more like a desert today than it did when they got there, but not much. Not a whole lot of it.
So those pictures down along the bottom of the screen, are they of that area?
Say it again.
All of those pictures, those slides down the bottom of the screen.
Oh,
are they?
They're from all over.
They're not at that specific area.
No, this is the Grand Canyon, Northern Arizona University, Phoenix, so forth.
Right.
It's just they're just kind of like a travelogue.
Oh, okay.
For Arizona, you can get out if you get out a little bit further out on the maps. Then sometimes they will. Like this, if you clicked on one of these, it would take us to that location. So you don't want to do that and get lost. Okay, so now we've been able to get in and do that, but we want to look further and get some idea of the more detail. And the and for example here, this is in Iowa, and this is the University of Iowa Libraries, and they have a set of county atlases for different counties in Iowa that you can look at. And what happens here with these maps is, let me blow it up quite a bit so you can see. Okay, so what you're looking at is a section, that red section of this map. These are called cadastral maps, C-A-D-A-S-T-R-A-L.
So if you want to go to that in a different state, what do you type into Google to get, or what do you type into somewhere?
You put in county atlas for whatever state you want.
County atlas?
Yeah, they're all over the, mostly in the Midwest and places like that. So you have a fairly substantial amount
now, does this particular one have
detail.
A date associated with it?
Or is this what?
Have a date associated with it?
Yeah, this one down there is 1911.
Oh, that there is. No.
Okay, so here's the process. Your people show up someplace. Let's say they show up in, who knows, Kansas, Iowa, Missouri. It doesn't really matter. Someplace. And they just show there. You don't know where they came from. You don't know who they're related to. You know, you're basically at a dead end with the people because you've traced it back and you found them in Iowa, and then that doesn't seem to lead you anywhere. Well, part of the problem that you're looking at is you're not really identifying them specifically enough. You have to really get in and start getting specific. Now you see those roads are going east and west and north and south. Those roads are along the property, the historical property lines that were created from that land survey system. So Well, that's why they're doing, if you're driving out here in the, in some places, I was just this last weekend in northern Arizona and southern Utah, and we drove, the road just went straight north, and then all of a sudden it went 90 degrees west, and then it turned 90 degrees straight north again. Well, those are called section turns. And basically, they built the roads around the sections so that the land inside the section doesn't have a road cut across it. So they follow the boundaries. So that's what they've done here. When they divided the land and when somebody took that homestead, the original homestead was all of the square, the road square. And so then these people have purchased parts of that since then.
On those particular maps, that 16 and 15 are those section numbers?
The what?
The 16 and 15, are those the section numbers?
I have no idea. I'd have to go through and see how they put their map together. They're probably the lot number from their system, whatever their system was. But the important thing here is, you've got somebody like here, this Mary Ross, and you can't see it, so I'll have to scroll it up a little bit. And you'll see down here it says the residence of J.F. Ross, and then you have Bernard and Mary Lynch here, and you have all these people. Well, your question is, who's Mary Ross? By getting into this detail of maps, you begin to see all of the neighbors. And the chances are that they're living next to relatives. And if they aren't living next to relatives, they're living next to friends. And if they're living next to friends, they're probably people that moved there with them who spoke the same language or came from the same part of the East or from the same part in Europe. And they all kind of migrated together and settled in one area. And the further back in time you go, the more likely that is to have happened. Here in Utah, we had all the people in Iceland came to one location. All the people from other places came, you know, they have colonies of people that came together and stayed together and lived in one community. And by ignoring that, by searching for the name of the person and saying, well, I just don't find any more information, you don't know what's going on. And my great-grandfather left a one-page biography. His next-door neighbor wrote a diary every single day and mentioned my grandfather about every page. So if you really want to know what happened to your ancestor, you might want to go to the next door neighbor. Maybe they're the one who wrote the all of the information down. And so this gives you the community, and searching communities is a lot easier than searching individuals because you've got more targets out there, more people to find out. If you go there, if you started doing research on every one of those people, it would not be unusual to find out that every single one of them came from the same eastern state. In fact, from the same eastern county.
And they're probably in-laws. And they're probably in-laws.
Yeah, and they're probably all related at some point. So this is kind of the point of identifying the exact location. The other point is that if there are the records that are associated with that particular location, once you know exactly where the person lived, not just the county or the state or whatever, we're not talking about, you know, Mary who lived in Ohio, who was from Ohio in about 1890, which doesn't give me anything at all to start with. We're now talking about somebody who lived on that piece of property in that little town in that county in 1911 or whenever it is. Now we can look at the county at the what's called the chain of title. Somebody obtained this property as a homestead and then sold portions of it off and tell all these people, or maybe they all just homesteaded that much, but usually there was one underlying homestead and then they divided it all up as they purchased the property. Well, you can go get that chain of title from various locations. You can work through a county the recorder office in the county and simply pick up a piece of property. For example, let's say your ancestor was this Mary Ross. You just go to the county and find out Mary Ross's property, what she bought. and then start working backwards through the records till you come up with the original owner of the property who got it from the United States government. That's called the chain of title. Now, people will do that for you. They're called title companies or abstract companies, but you're going to have to pay for it. So it's, you know, but you could call up a title company in Iowa and say, I have this property owned by Mary Ross, and it's in Calhoun County, Iowa, and it's the Lake Creek Township, and I'd like to know who owns that property. And if you, you know, they'll charge you a fee, they'll say, well, we charge $75 to look that up. And we say, fine, look it up. Or you say, too bad, too expensive, goodbye.
So how is the chain of title helping you with your genealogy?
Okay, so let's say you're going through the chain of title and it says that there was an executor's deed or an administrator's deed. That means there was a probate. So now you're going to go look for the probate, but instead of just looking through all the probate records, you have the actual date of the deed, which takes you right directly to the court record. Or let's say there's a disclaimer deed from the wife. The wife's interest in the property, called her dower interest in the property, and she signed a disclaimer because the husband sold the property. And that disclaimer deed tells what her maiden name was. It may be witnessed by members of her family. If she was the widow, it might be the widow's interest in the property. It's also a dower interest, but it's sometimes called the widow's interest. And the widow's interest, it's very possible that her maiden name is mentioned. These are records that give you, for example, you want to know what school district they were in. If you know exactly where they live, then you can find out which school district they were in. You want to know what church they went to. You want to know, all of that kind of information is developed from knowing specifically where they resided in the time period that they resided. When you don't know that information, if you only have a general idea, then you're shooting blind. You have no idea from the county, well, what school district were they in? Well, I don't know. Well, then are you going to search all the school districts in the county? What are you going to do? So you're really locking yourself out of a significant number of valuable records when you don't have the specific location. This becomes even more crucial when you're getting into countries like Denmark, Norway, Sweden, the Scandinavian countries, Wales, where people all have the same names, where you have a very limited number of variations on names. So if you have five people with the same parents' names who have the same name, who were born on the same day, how do you know which one's your ancestor? You can, because they have records that go down to household censuses that give you that kind of record. Tell you exactly who lived in which house. If you don't know about those records and you don't go through the trouble of determining exactly where they live, then you're lost.
If you look at that, you see the John W. Gregg, he has 80 acres, and T.P. Gregg has 79.
Oh yeah, they're all, okay, they're acreage.
You mentioned before.
No, I don't, that doesn't look like to me like that's an acreage.
That is an acreage.
Way too small.
I'll guarantee you it is.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, because Bernard and Mary Lynch have 160, Mary Ross has 160, the Heath, half that area has 80, and then there's 80.
Oh, okay.
And then the 79,
okay.
That's where those boundaries got adjusted because of the curvature of the earth.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. I didn't look at it closely enough.
Right, yeah. In this case, they have deeded part of the land to the church, which they often did.
That's true, too.
They have given an acre to that church down there.
It's more likely that
yeah, another thing, you'll see this one kind of sticks out, and you'll find descriptions, property descriptions, that says the northwest quarter or the northwest, northeast quarter, whatever, except for the east 20 feet of the southeast quarter and the west 37 feet of the north, you know. In other words, they start carving them up into measurements back and forth with feet. After a while, so these what seem to be very simple legal descriptions turn into very long, involved, and very contorted descriptions that you have to work through very carefully to see if it even makes sense.
Well, that alley quote system only goes down to 10 acres.
Yeah. Anytime you do anything below that, it starts to get complicated. Okay, well, that's sort of where it ends up today. There's more. We can go into the GIS system in another class, which will give us another way to look at the same kinds of things. Now, bear in mind this. The idea here was not to give you step-by-step instructions on how to do this. We have the handout that has the websites, but the idea here is to know that this is possible. Not that we, that we can do it ourselves every time, but we need to know that going down to that is necessary. Now, it may not be necessary. You may never run into this situation where you have to actually get down and figure out which house was which. But if you're at a dead end and you've stopped someplace in one of these things in the 1800s, 17, 1800s, 1900s, you really need to start looking at the land records. In the order of looking at records, we often start with birth, death, and sometimes marriage records, but birth and death records are the ones we seem to be more concerned with. When we should be starting with the marriage records, and then moving to probate records, and then moving to land records, and then moving to the other, because those are the ones that are always have priority of being preserved, and are the ones that are more extensive in identifying families and family groups. Okay, thanks.